us. Thank you very much for joining us today. I hope that it's not too cold wherever you happen to be logging in from. This is our fifth and final webinar of the Integrating the Truth and Reconciliation Commission Calls to Action in Nursing Education workshop series. I can't believe we've arrived to the final webinar. And we've been so grateful to have the CIHR Indigenous Health Research Chairs in Nursing who co-designed and are co-delivering this five-part series to support anti-racist and decolonial practices in nursing education as a collective response to implementing the TRC Calls to Action. Now, before we get started, I just wanted to mention a few things. If you've been in the last webinars, you've heard these before, but I will say them just to remind you. So due to the large number of participants, you'll be on mute for the duration of the presentation, but you're welcome to use the chat function to interact with each other during the presentation. And you can also use it to communicate with any of us, myself, James, and Lois that have CASN in their name. If you are having technical issues or you need any help, please just let us know. We're going to be using Mentimeter for some polling and discussion questions, and we'll be providing a link and a QR code right on the slides so you can access these questions and let us know what you're thinking and where you're at in response to what we're asking. You're able to listen to today's presentation in French or in English by clicking on the interpretation button. So there's a little globe icon at the bottom of your window. So if you click on there, you will be able to select French or English. And if you're on the French channel, you'll be listening to Darcy, our lovely interpreter. Thank you, Darcy. Today's presentation is going to be recorded and shared in the coming days. And since this is the final workshop, we're also going to be sending out an evaluation questionnaire to get your thoughts on the series as a whole, what you'll be taking forward in your work as educators or practitioners, as well as to hear your feedback just generally and thoughts on any future supports for nurse educators. So we would greatly appreciate if you would take just 5 minutes to fill out that online questionnaire when it's circulated. And now I will turn things over to my colleague Lois to introduce today's topic and our presenters and our knowledge holder, Judy.
Hello, everyone. Today we'll be hearing from knowledge holder Judy Pelly, Dr. Holly Graham, and Dr. Margot Latimer on implementing the calls to action to nursing education, nursing curricula. In Canada, we live and learn on the traditional territories of Indigenous people. We pay our respects to the First Nations, Métis, and Inuit ancestors and affirm our commitment to respectful relationships with one another and on this land. Here in Montreal, I'm situated on the land of the Mohawks, part of the Haudenosaunee Confederacy and Anishinaabeg Nations. I would like to honor the diverse Indigenous peoples connected to this territory on which I gather today. This webinar will be taking a closer look at calls to action 18 to 24 and how we can properly integrate them into nursing education. These are the questions you'll be asked to respond to throughout the course of the workshop. We want to see what action have you taken so far since this webinar was last offered, and how can you continue the good work? I will now pass it on to knowledge holder Judy Pelly to open this workshop and start us off in a good way. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and I'm so happy that I can be here. I always feel honored to be working in this area, especially my heart is also with healthcare in our Indigenous peoples. Prior to my retiring in 2015, I've been very, very busy with organizations, mostly in healthcare, that are working on the calls to action 18 to 24. And I always say I'm really happy to be alive to witness a lot of the things that are happening in terms of TRC. My mother was a very outspoken person as well about treaties and the loss of our language and culture, and about what happened in that dark history. And I always remember her in my prayers as well. And I wanna say that I've been smudging and praying. This is my third session today, and each time I smudge and I pray for all those that that are in our sessions. I don't do it online, so it's the way that my ancestors and my grandfathers and my parents have taught me not to to use media when I'm praying. So I just wanted to say that I will tell you that I ask the Creator to be with us today and to open our hearts and our minds to the very important work that we're about, that we're doing across Canada. And as well as the seven sacred teachings, I'm very, they conduct my everyday life. Truth and wisdom, and all the seven sacred teachings with respect, as well as most importantly, the courage and the bravery to be able to have those hard conversations as it relates to Indigenous people. As you know, we're all overrepresented in the healthcare system, and we have to, we do the best we can. And we have trendsetters, we have champions that are working really hard toward that. And I'm really happy to work with Holly Graham, Dr. Holly Graham, all the time, because she's one of our champions that is not afraid to speak out. She builds bridges and you know, that doesn't let anything hold her back. If there's boundaries, she'll find ways to deal with them. And with that, across the country, we're all doing the best we can in these implementations of the calls to action, and especially 18 to 24. And as it relates to nursing, practice in nursing, I'm also a member of the CRNS here in Saskatchewan, and lots of things going on. We have a video. I don't know if they're aware of this here, and the video would be so excellent for not only nurses but anybody that's that needs to know about that dark history and some of those things that happened. And as you know, the TRC calls to action came from the 6,000 residential school survivors, probably a lot of them not alive today, that had been damaged in those residential schools, and have made these at first recommendations, and now they're calls to action. And that our allies are, we have allies all over the country as well. And I always say, when we're working with these, we're preaching to the choir, because you're already doing what you can. But to help bring more people on board, share your knowledge, share your what you know. Even in my circles, I meet people that have no idea what calls to action is. They have no idea what the historic injustices that happen to Indigenous people. So in my circle, I do the best I can to talk to people. I work with a very vulnerable population in Saskatoon. I work with women at risk that are being put into gangs, to prostitution, coming out of jail, that are facing domestic violence and losing their children. And also in the acute care centers, I have entered and as often as I can, because I work with the Saskatchewan Health Authority as well. And to do the best I can to in whatever capacity I have. And I always say, the Creator brought us together. This is by no accident. Somehow, somewhere, something, we each and every one of us says to one another, we'll learn something. So when I go to bed at night, in the morning, I always pray that I'll do the best I can, wherever I can. That's all I can do. And then before I go to bed at night, I ask myself, what have I learned from each person that I've met today? What have I learned today? This is my third session already today. This morning I was at the detox, people detoxing from alcohol and drugs. And then I was at the FSIN because of missing and murdered Indigenous woman, a young 33-year-old woman that was murdered by her partner, I believe. And that she was 8.5 months pregnant, and they're only charging him for one, because they don't consider that it was another life. So all those things that I face every day, I try to bring it to the people that I work with, and to always remember those injustices. Don't just, and why we're overrepresented there, why there's so many, like sometimes 80% women in jail, sometimes 75% of the people that are coming into the acute care centers in emergency are Indigenous. I've been there, and I've dealt with racism myself. And so to continue that hard work, it's what's happened is is that you all work together. We all work together in the healthcare system to do what you can to make it a better place for the nurses that are there, that are working with our vulnerable population as well, that we do better, that we fight against racism, anti-racism. Make sure that if you see it and face it, face it, have the courage to be able to stand up and see what needs to be said or do what needs to be done. And so with that, I know I could go on and on, but you have an agenda. So I'm just going to say that I ask the Creator to bless you all as we're about to have these very important and sometimes challenging issues that we need to talk about in the healthcare system, especially with Indigenous, well, of course, with Indigenous nurses, and that we do the best we can to support them, for the Indigenous doctors and whatever else in the medical field. And with that, I will say thank you very much for having me.
Thank you, Judy, for that introduction and for that really important reminder of why we're here today. It keeps it very real. So I'm Holly Graham, a member of Thumbshell First Nations, my community. My mother and all her family attended the residential school and day school. So I grew up very much immersed in many of the issues we have noted through these five sessions in Indigenous communities and that occur in non-Indigenous communities as well, for Indigenous peoples when they interact outside of their community. So I'm very passionate about the work that I do and really grateful that we've had this opportunity to come together and to share our perspective on initiating and introducing and integrating these calls to action into nursing curriculum. My background is I'm a nurse. I've been a nurse for 38 years plus, and I also have a private practice as a registered doctoral psychologist and was awarded the ITER for Saskatchewan. And I'll let Margot introduce herself.
There we go. Hello, everyone. I'm coming to you from Mi'kma'ki, the unceded ancestral territory of the Mi'kmaq. I'm the I chair for Nova Scotia. I'm a professor in nursing at Dalhousie University and cross-pointed to IWK Health. And I'm not Indigenous. I'm of settler ancestry, Scottish ancestry to be specific. And I've been working with communities for about 15 years to use my nursing and research skills to support the priorities of communities. And I've been really honored to do that work. The Mi'kmaq have been here for up to 13,000 years is the latest years I understand. My family came here from Scotland about 125 years ago. So when I reflect on that reality, it really places in perspective my place as a visitor here, an uninvited visitor, and the work that I need to be doing to undo some of the harms of the past and how I can do that using my nursing knowledge and my research knowledge. So I'm working here provincially with Mi'kmaq leaders and nurses, as well as partnering with the provincial government and the schools of nursing to create some change, which we're going to share today. So thank you, Elder, for also coming today and sharing the reality of what it is that is the context that we want to start to work with. Thank you. So we wanted to start because this was the last sort of set with, are there burning questions remaining after we've come through all this webinar series? Are there burning questions that may be remaining for you that we haven't answered yet? So maybe those will be answered today. Hopefully most of them will. But if there are some burning questions, we're really interested to hear from you what they might be and how, if we can address them today, and if not, how we may be able to address them in the future. As we were waiting for the webinar to start, we started to talk with the CASN team about what are the next steps with this? How are we going to start to work on this? And how will we know if we've been successful and whether we've made progress. So if you want to log in here and let us know if you have some burning questions. And maybe we'll go back to this and keep moving. Does that make sense? No questions. That's great. Just the way that's put. I suspect that that's not true. So I think our plan was to see what your questions were and to go back to reflect on those closer to the end. So I think you had given me access to, yes, try and move my slides forward. I think we're having a little technical difficulty.
We are. Sorry, Margo. We just were switching back from Mentimeter. Lois, are you going to? Okay, there we go.
There we go.
We were having a little bit of technical issues.
I can't seem to.
Just while we're waiting for that to get sorted, I thought I really, really wanted to acknowledge my colleagues who hold the chairs and the Indigenous nursing chairs, Holly, Dr. Wanda Phillips-Beck, Dr. Lisa Bork-Bearskin, for their persistence with this work. They've been doing this work for a number of years, and the chairs have been the first opportunity to create a collective and to have myself and Dr. Jason Hickey and Amelie Blanchette to support them in their work. And so it's really been, again, an opportunity to see what the challenges have been in the work that they've been doing, and to also partner and create this partnership. So I just want to honor the work that they have been doing for a number of years, and to say that, you know, as the end of this series, that we look to all of you to work along with us as we move it forward. So thank you. It looks like we've got things sorted. So we wanted to quickly review the TRC calls to action for the schools of nursing. So 24 is the hot topic because this is the new CASN accreditation that schools of nursing will be accredited on, calling on medical and nursing schools to require all students to take a course dealing with Aboriginal health issues, including history, legacy of the residential schools, the UNDRIP treaties, Aboriginal rights, and Indigenous teachings and practices. Also, skills-based training in competency, conflict resolution, human rights, and anti-racism. So we can go to the next one. So this is the accreditation call based on that TRC call to action, and recognizing CASN's role as a national accrediting body for education programs. The curriculum is to address this call to action, and just reflecting what it was that I just read. Next one. So call to action 18 is related to calling on the federal, provincial, and territorial governments and to work with Aboriginal governments to acknowledge that the current state of health for Indigenous people in Canada is a direct result of the colonizing Canadian government policies, including the residential schools, and to recognize and implement healthcare rights of Indigenous people as identified by international law, constitutional law, and under the treaties. And I think that this call kind of gets glazed over sometimes because people really aren't sure how to unpack this call. But really, when you learn a little bit more through our presentation, what we're doing, you can see how These laws and treaties are so important. It is the inherent right of Indigenous people to have access to their own knowledge and practices. And we have to be able to break down that system and teach ourselves as non-Indigenous people and students what that information is and how to implement that into practice. So it carries over into the practice settings. So all of these pieces are so important to understand and figure out how it all works together. Call 19, calling upon the federal government in consultation with the engagement of Indigenous peoples to establish measurable goals to identify and close the gaps in health outcomes. And so again, it's not the responsibility of Indigenous people, but Indigenous people need to be involved to be able to say what that looks like, what are the indicators of health. And so we need that partnership. Next. 20, in order to address the jurisdictional disputes concerning Indigenous people who do not reside in community, we call upon the federal government to recognize, respect, and address the distinct health needs of Indigenous people. And we also call upon the federal government to provide sustainable funding for new Indigenous health centers to address the four dimensions of health for Indigenous people. So these are all really related to the work that we do as nursing schools and how we prepare nurses for practice and leadership, policy, and research. Next slide. So the remaining calls, we've already reviewed 24, but 22 is around increasing Indigenous professionals working in the healthcare field, ensuring the retention of Indigenous health providers, and providing cultural competency training for health professionals in practice. So it's been a number of years since these calls have come out. There's only some of the calls that have been addressed, but these seem to be most pressing and completely related to the work we do. Next slide. 62 is calling upon the federal and provincial and territorial governments in consultation with the residential school survivors to provide necessary funding for post-secondary institutions to educate the faculty and teachers on how to integrate this Indigenous knowledge into our teaching methods and into our classrooms. Again, this is another call that not a lot of people seem to be aware of, but we need to consider how we respond to this call in addition to the others. So as you can see, it's not just a course. I think people only see 24, and with the CASN accreditation really focuses on that particular call, but that call is integrated with all of these other calls that we've just reviewed, and you can see how they overlap. And so we can't just say, let's get a course. We have to say, okay, how does this all connect and how can we create this network of support to answer all of these calls? So this is self-explanatory. I think I've spoken a little bit about this already. We are trying to emulate, I guess, through our work as the chairs, how this is not just the responsibility alone of Indigenous people, that we want to be able to work together in partnership here in Mi'kmaq. We call it two-eyed seeing. It's the co-creation of working together and working with the knowledge, Indigenous knowledge, how we can support moving that together for in a meaningful way. So in order to do that, we really need to understand the colonial history. What does it mean when we do a land acknowledgement? Most of the places that where I work, I don't work a lot of places, but the two places where I'm involved with, the health setting and the university setting, have adopted the land acknowledgement. But what does that really mean when we say that out loud? How does that carry us in our work practically, what does it mean when we create our policies and our practices in our schools of nursing and our healthcare settings? Where are we located, and what is our obligation and accountability to the First Peoples of the land in which we live? What are our relationships with the local Indigenous people? And what does it mean to say we are all treaty people? So both Indigenous people and the people of the Crown signed the treaties. And so what does that mean? What is our obligation as a result of that history? Something to reflect on and understand. So I'm going to pass this over to Holly.
Sure. I just thought I'd share is just traveling up to East, going to Halifax, and even noticed with Air Canada that they were giving a land acknowledgement in there. And I think about land acknowledgement, probably one of the most important reasons to be giving it and to be talking about it, is that oration that keeps alive the history of the treaties and the acknowledgement that the Indigenous peoples were here first in the lands that we now call Canada. So I just wanted to share, and we'll be sharing examples throughout where we've seen representation or symbols or images that represent and bring to life this relationship between Indigenous and non-Indigenous peoples in Canada. I can't hear it, and I don't know if anyone else can hear. This is Tim Guest giving a professional response to TRC Calls to Action. If you want to start that again.
I can't hear him either. Can't hear.
I'll just try and reshare. Sorry, everyone, for the technical difficulties. We did practice and it worked okay. Mm-hmm. But of course, it's giving us some challenges at this time.
So part of our conversation today and discussion is to really get those of you thinking where you're working, what responses have you heard, what's happening in your province, and to give you some ideas of what different people are doing across Canada. So it's just to inspire those of you to take and to be able to take more action in your respective provinces. So if we can get this to work.
Hello, my name is Tim Guest. I'm a registered nurse, and I am the CEO of the Canadian Nurses Association. Thank you for inviting me to speak on my vision for reconciliation within nursing education and practice. I would like to begin by acknowledging that I am speaking to you from the unceded territory of the Mississaugas of the Credit, the Anishinaabeg, the Chippewa, the Haudenosaunee, and Wendat people. It is now home to many diverse First Nations, Inuit, and Métis people. In order for the healthcare system and nursing practice to truly serve Indigenous nurses and patients, the system must accept truth and reconciliation efforts. The work that is being done by the Indigenous research chairs and by others is a great step in the right direction. However, reconciliation is not the work of Indigenous peoples alone. It is also the work of non-Indigenous people. Truth and reconciliation in healthcare and nursing practice is an ongoing learning experience with required reflection on the past and action towards a better future. The healthcare system and nursing profession need to learn to better serve Indigenous patients and Indigenous nurses. The Truth and Reconciliation Call to Action 24 speaks to the need for all students to be taught about Aboriginal health issues, history and legacy of residential schools, the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People, treaties and Aboriginal rights, Indigenous teachings and practices. I believe it is essential that nursing curriculum is adapted to include this content. It is important that our current and future nurses gain a greater understanding of Indigenous culture, practices, and experiences. The nursing profession must eliminate systemic racism in all forms and it is vital for future nurses to learn from a strong curriculum that focuses on truth and reconciliation. Key components must include trauma-informed practice, training on anti-Indigenous racism in nursing and healthcare, promote cultural competence, and provide a safer anti-racist healthcare system for Indigenous communities. If you're interested in learning more about the efforts of the Canadian Nurses Association, please visit our website and learn more about our Indigenous Advisory Council. Thank you for inviting me to speak with you today. Hello.
I'll let Margot continue with the discussion here with CASN's new document on anti-racism.
Yeah, thank you. So I'm sure people are aware of this document around the framework of strategies for nursing education responding to the TRC calls to action. Do you want to move forward? There are three main components of this document: the foundational supports within the learning environment, recruitment and retention, and curricular strategies. And so you can see on, for me as an English speaker, on the left-hand side of the screen, under the column of foundational supports in the learning environment, partnerships, faculty staff training, institutional respect, a welcoming environment. So you can read through in each of those buckets what has been proposed. So designated seats, pre-admission outreach, related to recruitment and retention. I won't read through all of them, you can see them there. And then the curricular strategies. So you can start to see from the TRC calls to action how those calls are reflected, even though it's not just 24, how those calls are reflected within this framework. Next slide. So we have another mentee question. After engaging with all the webinars, how do you plan to integrate the calls to action 18 to 24 in your workplace? So we'll ask you to log in using the code 4527-5577 at mentee.com. Let's hope the mentee works. Oh, it won't move off the last question, somebody's saying. Must be something happening today in the virtual electronic universe. Oh, can we post the code? It's here at the top of the screen. But Christine, are you able to post the code in the chat?
Yes, we can do that.
Okay. Great. Great. So I see also in the chat, one of the comments from one of the member of the chair team, Indigenous nurses must be authentically engaged and compensated in this work. That's such an important point. You can imagine since the TRC calls to action have come out, Indigenous people, Indigenous nurses have been been asked to be involved, and a lot of it's a lot of work to do this work, and so and sharing of their Indigenous knowledge is part of their knowledge, part of their history, needs to be compensated properly. So these are great. Incorporate Indigenous designed educational materials. Informed how we can integrate the calls to action in the course content. Take learning each week to understand, take time to learn each week. Discussion about ethics, yeah, and social justice relations. Have places reserved for students. Indigenous students. We need to find resources to fund these endeavors. Absolutely. That is definitely something that needs to also be acknowledged. Great. That's great. Excellent feedback. So we'll go on. Thank you very much for engaging in that and thinking about that. You've already started to work on it. I'm sure more ideas will come. I'm going to turn it back to Holly now to introduce this video.
Yeah, so knowing that TRC Calls Action 24 is now required for accreditation, recognize that there's a bit of gap. Some, I was teaching a graduate class last year in nursing, and 50% of the students who are from across Canada had not heard of TRC Calls to Action. So one of the things that we've done here in Saskatchewan as part of the chair work is I partnered with the College of Registered Nurses of Saskatchewan to create and provide this educational video for healthcare providers in the province. So it's 7 minutes, and we'll just show that to you and look forward to some of your thoughts afterwards. There'll be a Mentimeter about this video. Thanks, and we'll just let Lois or Christine start the video, please.
Current health disparities experienced by Indigenous peoples are rooted in colonization. Saskatchewan healthcare leaders are taking action to reduce these disparities and create safer spaces where all people can receive the care they need with dignity and respect.
Canadian colonial history and nursing history will be rewritten in coming years with the truths Indigenous, First Nations, Métis, and Inuit peoples have known for many decades.
The current health disparities and inequitable access to health care experienced by Indigenous peoples in Canada must be conceptualized within the context of the past and present manifestations of colonialism. All Canadians require an accurate account of the past and ongoing colonial relationship between the Canadian government and Indigenous peoples to dismantle the systemic inequities such as access, bias, and discrimination.
In the spring of 2023, in the Opinahaw Valley of Wanuskewin Heritage Park, Saskatchewan health leaders gathered to solemnly reflect on the legacy of pain, suffering, and genocide inflicted upon Indigenous peoples.
As healthcare providers, we apologize for the cultural genocide committed against Indigenous peoples and acknowledge that the healthcare system and nursing education programs are embedded with colonial hierarchical power structures, thinking, and practices. We must collectively commit to learning their truths and our Canadian history to develop authentic, meaningful, and respectful relationships with all Indigenous peoples.
Reconciliation requires recognizing this colonial history and for all nurses to respond to the Truth and Reconciliation calls to action. As nurses, we are committed to including First Nation, Métis, and Inuit perspectives and ensuring their knowledge systems are honored, respected, valued, and integrated into nursing practice.
The nursing community in Saskatchewan acknowledges that as healthcare providers and carers, that we have history of causing harm to Indigenous people. We are committed to educating and supporting registered nurses to identify racism that is perpetuated in healthcare settings, and more importantly, to support registered nurses to intervene, to ensure safe environments, and to address acts of racism within their workplaces.
We reside in the traditional lands of the Nahiwak, Nakawewak, Nakota, Dakota, Lakota, the Nechipewyan, and the traditional homeland of the Métis. As members of this land called Saskatchewan, we live and work in Treaty 2, 4, 5, 6, 8, and 10 territories.
To share your heart, to make a brand new start, and watch the walls come tumbling down.
We will diligently work towards addressing the current health disparities between Indigenous and non-Indigenous peoples in Canada. We can begin reconciliation by answering the calls to care through the calls to action.
I will learn about the history and legacy of the residential schools and government policy that has created the health disparities.
I will acknowledge the intergenerational impacts of colonialism on Indigenous health and well-being.
I will commit to integrating a holistic approach to health that includes spiritual, emotional, physical, and mental wellness.
I will learn how to integrate Indigenous healing practices into my nursing practice.
I will value Indigenous healing practices and learn how to integrate them into my nursing practice where requested by Indigenous peoples.
I will continue to be an ally, supporting Indigenous nurses and clients within all healthcare environments.
I will take action to dismantle systemic racism in healthcare, starting with my own practice setting.
I am committed and dedicated to working with other nursing leaders within Saskatchewan and beyond to effect positive change within the healthcare system to make it more equitable and culturally safe for all those that are in need of care.
We will support truth and reconciliation by fostering collaborative relationships with First Nations, Inuit, and Métis peoples.
With your help as Indigenous people, nurses can learn from your stories, your strengths, your courage, and guidance as we walk in partnership towards a time of understanding and compassion to make a change.
Together, we are responding to the truth and reconciliation calls to action and will create positive change for the people of Saskatchewan.
Relating the past to today, the acknowledgement was made that systemic racism still exists within Saskatchewan's healthcare system. The commitments made by the Saskatchewan health leaders are in response to the 2015 Truth and Reconciliation Commission report. The report included 94 calls to action to begin dismantling systemic racism devastating Indigenous peoples in Canada. The calls to action address the areas of child welfare, education, language and culture, justice and health. More information on how you can begin to address the health disparities Indigenous people experience are available at the National Center for Truth and Reconciliation and the Indigenous Nursing Professional Practice Group.
Thank you. So this video, and you are welcome to use this video anytime you want, share to your students in any capacity to share this. I would welcome any of my colleagues to use the video. So I just want a reminder, like these whole workshops, everything we're doing here about the calls to action, which was spoken about in this video, it is to reduce the health disparities between Indigenous and non-Indigenous peoples. And these TRC calls to action, these different areas, were co-created by Indigenous peoples across the country as to what would make a difference, how we can bring Indigenous peoples into the fabric of Canadian society in all aspects within our country. So that's why these call to actions are fundamental in terms of if we are able to start addressing the calls to action. So there's a Mentimeter. What are some ways that you have thought of between the webinars starting from one to now, perhaps that you can facilitate more action in your province so that more people know about the TRC calls to action? Because it is really surprising how many people have not had the opportunity, and I think it's really about knowledge mobilization and knowledge translation. How do we get this message out there? Because surprisingly, even though the TRC calls to actions were released in 2015, there are many who do not are aware of it or the contents. Thus means they're not taking any action. And we'll provide the links afterwards if you're having trouble. They're all in the professional practice group as well that I started in Saskatchewan. So all the links for all these videos are there as well. So we're just waiting for some of your responses to come in and the Mentimeters, just some areas that you've thought about, how you're going to facilitate awareness about TRC calls to action. And so far, I'm not seeing anything that's come in. I am very grateful and have much gratitude to have such wonderful partners that I do, the College of Registered Nurses of Saskatchewan. They have been tremendous in supporting all the work that I do in this province, and they have uplifted so much of what I've done and have made this work so much easier. So I'm just very grateful to have them and the membership who are so receptive, supportive, and committed to addressing health disparities. So some people are having some trouble accessing the Mentimeter. Join hospital boards and policy development. That's great. We have to get to policy. That's what we'll start changing the structure. Thank you, Christina, for putting that in. Yes, that was one of the things I did in Saskatchewan was started an Indigenous practice group within the regulatory board. And that practice group allows direct communication between our regulatory board, CRNS, and Indigenous nurses in our province so that we can preview any documents, policy related to Indigenous health, and we can also partner on initiatives together towards reducing health disparities and provide support for our nursing workforce in Saskatchewan. Yes, sharing videos. We have more videos to share, absolutely. So we only have two responses. It is something to think about while we're talking, and perhaps some of you are still, you know, thinking about it. I'm that kind of person myself. I have to think about something for a while before I take action. But these are the types of things we'd like you to start thinking about, how you can start some of these changes and take some of this action in your workplace. Taking opportunities to make change by incorporating new practices. Absolutely. I think I'll let Margo start the next section, looking at partnerships with Indigenous peoples.
Yes, yeah, so I wanted to share, we wanted to share this work done by Brown about how important the partnerships are with Indigenous people. So I know my colleagues at Dalhousie are really keen to start this work and address the TRC calls to action. And but how do we do this when we don't have Indigenous faculty? We have one Indigenous faculty at Dal who is not a nurse and who works part-time. And so it's really challenging to move the work forward when we don't have meaningful partnerships with Indigenous people. So really beginning that partnership, and again, I'll talk a little bit more later in the presentation about how we've done that, but right now highlighting that the partnerships, action at all level between patient provider organizations and health systems, attention to the local and global histories. One thing that often comes up is people's eagerness to do something, but often resonates as a pan-Indigenous approach. So we really have to respect the local history of the nations where you live, because it may not, well, residential school is a common historical piece across the country. There are different histories, beliefs, practices, languages, depending on who your local nation is. Attention to unintended and potentially harmful impacts of each strategy. This is a really key piece because while we may be eager to do things, we may go about doing it in not in the way that Indigenous people want us to do it. So that's why the partnerships are so key. Next slide. So within Brown's work, they identified 10 strategies to guide equity-oriented services with Indigenous people. So this is based on the healthcare system delivery of care to Indigenous people. But of course, we are preparing nurses to go into that health system as practicing nurses, as health leaders, as policy analysts, as researchers. So we need to kind of keep the big picture and the big context in mind. So explicitly committing to fostering health equity, developing policies and structures that facilitate that. Recently, I've been asked to get involved with doing some cultural safety training with other members of the Mi'kmaq chair team here. And it's challenging just to do the training when the policies aren't in place to support what we're training people to do. So all of these pieces have to fit together. Optimizing use of place and space, use of time, power differentials are a real thing. I think we all understand that within our own context, tailoring care and programs. Actively countering racism and discrimination. So this is back to policies, whether we have a meaningful and effective policy in this area, and we can be advocates for that. Ensuring meaningful engagement of students in our case, but also in the health system, patients and community leaders. And even in our own situations, what is the experience of patients who are receiving care from our students? Tailor care to address the social determinants of health. So we teach the social determinants of health, but sometimes I wonder, are we really applying them in our support of students? And do we recognize that Indigenous students in our schools of nursing are experiencing the social determinants of health themselves? They're from communities, they have been disadvantaged by this past. And so we need to apply what we're teaching also to our students and our colleagues who we work with. Next. So we have another question. How have you begun to establish your relationships with local Indigenous staff, student, faculty, communities, and organizations? Have people begun to do this work, and how is that going, and what have you done to establish that?
Margo, can I just add that the social determinants of health, it applies to nursing students, like you said, but it also applies to Indigenous, First Nation, Métis, Inuit staff. It applies to faculty who are Indigenous. It's not just the students who continue
to
experience these disparities. Like I always tell my colleagues, you know, as we get older and more of our family are having health problems, you know, if you take whatever challenges you're having in your family with health, you multiply that 3 to 5 times, that's what an Indigenous person, First Nation, is actually experiencing. And that starts to put it in a better context of that it never goes away. Even when you become educated, become a registered nurse, and you have a job, those issues of social determinants of health, of poverty, and of social determinants of health do not change for many of our family and our close relatives. So it still continues to impact. So it never goes away when you're born into Indigenous health. And so I think that that understanding of that context really is a part of recruiting and retaining Indigenous peoples, you know, in the workplace. Thanks.
So I'm having trouble seeing the screen that's kind of shaded out. I don't know if that's happening for other people. So I wonder if, yeah. Oh, now it's really shaded out. There we go. Thank you. So people have started to establish relationships. We have Indigenous Student Resource Coordinator at our college. Wonderful. Somebody's saying we need to refresh the web page. There we go. Call out privately when hear or read students speaking disrespectfully of other students. Yes, that's definitely an important part of our role. And helping people feel confident in doing that, helping them understand and maybe giving practice and running through scenarios to do that. Reconnecting with local Indigenous groups. Indigenous placements for students to facilitate learning, that's wonderful. And also making sure those Indigenous students feel welcome. So it's it's a placement in an Indigenous setting, I think that one is. And what goes along with that is the evaluation piece. So the indicators of success for a student in that placement may be different than what our School of Nursing already has established. So making sure that what the placement expects is what we're supporting the student to do, if that makes sense. Great. Presenting proposals and research to both Indigenous students and staff, ask for their feedback. So for presenting the proposals, perhaps we could engage them to be part of the proposals, if it's about them, if it's about Indigenous strategies, it would be important to be engaging the students and staff as part of the process, perhaps. Addressing microaggression every time, yes, consistency. Establish trust when engaging. We had a dialogue with, can you move the screen up a little bit? Yeah. It was creating an art project, reflections on what it means to be a nurse. Nice. Great. These are great strategies and really relationship building strategies from what I see. Connecting with Indigenous scholars to work with curriculum development and student support community engagement. Great. Wonderful. Beading workshop on an Orange Shirt Day. Great. Really wonderful. Great. Nice. Yeah, and it seems other places are similar, that they're bringing Indigenous nurses in to teach. And back to Christina's comment about compensation, that's an important part of that. Okay, maybe we'll move on. So we wanted to include some of the questions that we asked in webinar three, the webinar three I was involved with. And we asked the participants of that webinar to reflect and respond to these questions about themselves. I continuously examine my beliefs, presumptions, and biases about Indigenous peoples. I intervene appropriately and effectively in situations when I witness racism. In my institution, an anti-racist philosophy and an actionable policies and procedures have been implemented, and I'm equipped to provide anti-racist care and or use an anti-racist approach in nursing education. So it really just gives us a sense. I know maybe some of you participated, but this is from a previous webinar, and I thought it might be helpful to share a glimpse of how the respondents from that webinar were faring in some of these areas. So we'll go to the next slide. So you can see with the key along the bottom, related to examining beliefs and self-biases, a small section of people disagreed with that, somewhat disagreed that they were doing, and a larger percentage of people agreed. So 86% felt that they were examining their biases. But when it came to intervening appropriately and effectively with racism, people disagreed. The majority of responders disagreed with that, 60%. And in the same vein, that their institution where they worked had an anti-racist policy, and also that responder who felt equipped to provide anti-racist education and care. So 56% and 65%. So you can see that for these responders, they were feeling as though they weren't appropriately, they didn't feel they could intervene appropriately. Their institution didn't have the policies and they didn't feel equipped. And so the majority. So I think while people are reflecting on their beliefs and biases, we have some work to do with providing the support for people working within the schools of nursing to feel confident and comfortable to be doing this work. So it's really kind of neat to see your previous answers around addressing racism and tackling microaggression every time. But we also need to understand that maybe people don't feel equipped to be doing that work. Next slide. We'll pass this over to Holly.
Yeah, so I'm just going to talk a little bit about some of the work that has been done in Saskatchewan, starting with the College of Nursing at the University of Saskatchewan, which I was there for 13 years. So one of the first things I did was updated the symbol they had that to represent First Nation, Métis, and Inuit nurses. So this is a symbol you see over and over. So the kudlik is of the Inuit people, the beadwork, and the drum, and the sky and mendamin, there's other elements of First Nation and Métis. And the eagle is one of the sacred teachings that represents love. And the Métis sash, of course, for Métis people, you've got the three generations here. So that's just a symbol. And symbols are really important as they create the opportunity for people when they walk in to feel comfortable, to feel a part of it, and to see that their perspective and who they are is actually accepted and viewed as, you know, something that has value. And I think that's a big part of it, is feeling that you have value. So I've tried to take over control, but I cannot advance that well. So maybe I can give that back to you. The next is just an image of the model I created when I applied for the chair. And it really was looking about how do we bring in Indigenous worldview. And I looked specifically at holistic practices of health, physical, mental, emotional, spiritual dimensions, and then looked at the sacred teachings of how that affects the development of character. Well, there was an Indigenous advisory that actually provided an overview and support to me as well. Then I really looked at reconciliation and mentorship. So that's what you're going to see in the next few slides, is some of the initiatives related to that. And my first goal was not to do any harm. So the next slide talks a little bit about the medicine wheel and the sacred teachings. And those are the ones that Knowledge Keeper Judy referred to at the beginning: humility, bravery, honesty. And there's seven of them. And looking at, this is a frame and an Anishinaabe teaching. And it's actually a frame of philosophy and value system of how to be in relationship with ourselves and with each other and with Mother Earth. and is to create harmony when we live within these value systems. The next picture is an image of a CFI space that I'm currently working on, and it will have its grand opening in March. And the name of the space, I'm with the College of Medicine Department of Psychiatry now, and the name of the space is Good Medicine People. And it has been translated into the 6 different languages for First Nations and Métis in Saskatchewan. The 4th one, Mio Muskegee-Inuak, means good medicine people. And you can see the buffalo, the bear, and the raven, the eagle, the beaver, and of course the turtle has the value system. So this is what the outside of the space looks like. And the space has been designed with the intention to teach cultural safety competence and a skills lab that will help with teaching how to stand up, how to advocate when one witnesses racism in healthcare. The next slide is actually showing you what's been done at our Royal University Hospital. There's a little bit about the teachings of our ancestors, and I'll let you review them at your own pace. You'll get them with the PowerPoint slides after. And the next slide just is a little bit about Wapate Healing Center, which is Soto, and it just really talks about the glow of daylight, you know, that gives our body when we're balanced. So it talks about creating that glow as a reference for what health and wellness is. The next slide just talks about humility, and it's been translated into the same 6 languages that I showed with the initial space. So why these spaces are important for Indigenous peoples, when we say Indigenous, we're referring to First Nations, Métis, and Inuit. And it is important to know that it is distinction based, and each of these groups of people have very different perspectives and approaches and worldviews. But what it does is it shows valuing and acceptance. And it's a way of saying, this is your space too. You can come in here and see space and pictures and images that reflect your worldview. Like the flowers there with the petals is very significant, the 4. It's part of the creation story of the flower teachings in there. So I was keeping in line with this space. So I wanted to share these examples just as an idea of what's being done. When I was in Denmark before COVID, it was so amazing in their hospital. We had a conference there. It didn't even feel like a hospital, but they had traditional art from their own Indigenous peoples all throughout the hospital, sculptures and paintings. And it was absolutely beautiful and stunning. And I don't think we've reached that point in Canada. The next slide is just the beginning of sharing the Indigenization plan here at the University of Saskatchewan within the College of Nursing. So it's just to give you an idea, if you're looking at a strat plan, you have to have a strat plan, a strategy plan, in order for you to have metrics to know, are you meeting it or not meeting it? So these are just some examples of, you know, embracing and supporting diversity and valuing and evaluating our relationships. You know, how are we engaging and what types of quality of relationships do we have? Take into consideration all those things we talked about with cultural safety, about power dynamics and establishing reciprocal relationships. On the next slide, there's some examples of Indigenization objectives. I think you have to back up one, Lois. And so it's about having access to supports that are culturally appropriate, that everyone is educated about the TRC calls to action, and that Indigenous students, staff, and faculty and emeritus alumni are included as part of looking for solutions and really teaching the priorities of issues towards resolving, not resolving, but moving towards reconciliation in a way to reduce the health disparities. So just some examples when you're writing your own strat plan. And when you go further on of some initiatives, the next slide, it talks about graduate student diversity. We have to actually actively recruit. And this does sometimes mean equity seats, and that is important. So if you're looking at metrics for each one of these for employee diversity, in Saskatchewan, we have put up approximately 18% First Nation peoples. That would be the goal, to have 18% of all our graduate students enrolled in our university, 18% First Nation and Métis. Employee diversity, 18%. So those would be measurable metrics that we could see, are we meeting them or are we not? And then of course, looking at the content and the types of support. The next slide talks about our university strategic plan, which is the overarching. And that was created by Dr. Jacqueline Ottman when she was the Vice Provost for Indigenous Engagement. And this was done in a collective, participatory, where all Indigenous First Nation, Métis, and Inuit staff, faculty, clinical instructors were brought together. And this was over several days, several engagements, where we really came together. And then with the analysis, they came up with these 7 fundamental commitments. And I think more universities have these. I just wanted to share with you from Saskatchewan University. So it's about safety, it's about wellness and stewardship, representation, relationships, next slide, creation, and renewal. So these are just ideas for you if you're looking for ideas of how to do your own strat plan and how to start doing a prioritization, some way to make very concrete the calls to action. These existing strat plans are, you know, a foundation perhaps of where to start. On the next slide, you know, it's really important when we talk about this work to really know that there are mistakes. We're all going to make mistakes. But when we look at sometimes what happens is sometimes we only talk about it, you know, June 30th on Indigenous National Day or Truth and Reconciliation Day on September 30th. So being very day specific, not looking at it, that this is an everyday process to include Indigenous peoples in the fabric of everything that we do, and not doing it in isolation. And also acknowledging the assistance that Indigenous peoples are giving, and that it's actually acknowledged, whether it's a publication, that their name is on it, if it's a report, that their name is also included. And it's really important to be considerate when we're asking people to continuously share their perspective as the toll that that may be taking on them. So just some ideas there, and just to further stimulate some thought. One of the things on the next slide we did at Saskatchewan, we've done it 3 years in a row, was on TRC September 30th is 2 weeks in advance. Our communication person puts out a call to everyone, please let us know what you'd like us to include with our social media. And this is an example of one of my colleagues, Tish King, what she wrote, you need to put a picture in. And then it's a part of showing our students that we're engaging, we know what this day means and how we're participating. Just one example. June 21st is the next slide, the National Indigenous Peoples Day. You know, what do you do as faculty? Do you go and participate? Is this an opportunity to go and learn and celebrate with Indigenous peoples? Just important to know that we teach about those days and that we start participating in these days to improve our own knowledge about this history. On the next slide, it's about knowledge mobilization. And really looking at what does that mean on mobilization and how do we start doing that? So you can see on the next slide that there's some mugs that I've created as part of my work at USASC. There's a jacket that has the logo. And this piece of art was commissioned by Kevin Pace, and he's one of our local First Nation artists. And he did the baby in the moss bake for Every Child Matters. That was 2 years ago. And we've taken that piece of art and put it on t-shirts and mugs. And what we've also done is commissioned that he receives 15% of commission on every item sold forever. And I think that it's important to look at artists' rights and Indigenous artists, that they are compensated initially and throughout any profit made. So that's just an example. The next slide is a video. And I did 10 of these videos, and it was really about recruitment, responding to one of the calls to action. How do we get Indigenous peoples into nursing, and how do we let them know like what opportunities are available? So I'm just going to let Lois play. It's 60 seconds. It's not long. And we can't hear it, Lois. You may have to start it over again, please. So there were 10 of these recruitment videos done while she's getting it up. Undergraduate, graduate, NPs, masters, PhDs, of students in Saskatchewan who have completed their nursing program. So,
what do I love about it the most? Would probably be the diversity of it. And that was my whole goal. When I make changes, I make big changes. So I went from being in the military to working construction to nursing. I've worked in rehab medicine. I've done outpost nursing up north. I've done orthotrauma. I'm currently working in mental health, and I'm considering going back to school to upgrade for wound care.
I love being able to try different things that are completely different. And I get to do what I love doing the most. I get to help people. I get to work with people. And that's pretty much why I became a nurse.
So I created 10 of these videos, and you are welcome to use them. Anybody can take them to promote and recruit Indigenous peoples into nursing. And I please take them and use them. So they're also on the website. We wanted to share with you a TRC report card that was done. And it's really interesting because when you look at measurement and evaluation, we're actually kind of, I would say, on the weaker side of that. But some of the key findings is we have to improve recruitment. And that's one of the reasons I worked on these videos. We have to have Indigenous peoples in healthcare in every aspect of the Canadian fabric so that we can start addressing these disparities we see in every area. It's not just in health. Of course, Indigenous cultural safety has to accommodate Indigenous students. So we have to look at the impact it has on Indigenous students as well, the type of training that we're doing. Cultural support and faculty need to have more knowledge and education and be able and feel comfortable talking about this history in ways that promotes understanding and awareness. And probably important to note was that there was very little change that has actually occurred. So we could do report cards with CASN. We can have our nursing students fill out a report card to CASN about how their respective educational institutes are doing in terms of teaching these concepts that we've outlined. There are different ways we could collect this data to see how we're doing. And the next slide shows, you know, thinking about differently. I took my dog to the vet here at the University of Saskatchewan, and it was really interesting. Have you been waiting 20 minutes or longer? Let them know. How many people go to our ERs and they wait far longer than 20 minutes? And in the cases of such as Brian Sinclair actually pass away and not receiving any attention. So I think we can be innovative in many ways when we're looking at access and how that can be improved for all peoples, not just Indigenous peoples. Thanks. Let Margot share a little bit about what she's doing out on the east side.
Great. Thanks, Holly. So similar to Holly's work, you saw in the first video she showed, we've been engaging leaders. I've been working with Mi'kmaq leaders here provincially. And really, this is leading the work, Don Gugu, who's actually also on the webinar and will be presenting. So if you want to move forward. And the community vision of the chair was to advance Indigenous health nursing through education, practice, and research approaches. And you can see Don here with Elder Anne Labilawa and one of the previous students, Dylan Jowdry, who is now a nurse. In the space that we've created within our School of Nursing, it's the Indigenous student space, a safe space for students to meet up, to have the support of Dawn, who is the Oumu nursing lead for the province through the chair. She's been hired through the chair, not the university at this point, but we have plans for that. Next slide. And so we've been working with the Mi'kmaq Health Lead, Health and Wellness Organization here in Nova Scotia called Dajigimuk. And we've developed this team across the provincial partners with Dajigimuk, the Nova Scotia Departments of Health and Wellness, Department of Advanced Education, the chair, and the educational institutions across the province who offer nursing education. So similar to Holly's work, we have engaged the leadership and the provincial partners who are responsible and doing, you know, for education, nursing education, in this conversation and now actively working towards putting a strategy in place. I don't seem to be able to advance my slide there. So key areas identified within the Nova Scotia Action Plan for Health. This is our provincial action plan. So we are really dovetailing with the action plan, which states they want to address the healthcare needs of communities, understand and address systemic racism, improve access to culturally appropriate services, and leadership development for Indigenous Nova Scotians. So all of this fits within the provincial Oulu nursing strategy. Next slide. So, So within the education, can we go to the next one? So we've created this Oulu Trailblaze Nursing Path, the Indigenous Nursing Success Survey, which we're just getting through the REB ethics, recruitment and retention of Indigenous peoples into nursing, both undergraduate and graduate, the Engagement Center. We have created cultural safety curriculum for all first year nursing, medicine, dentistry, pharmacy, and dental hygiene. Safe learning spaces and a trauma-informed school of nursing is the plan. Next. So within the context of Nova Scotia, similar to what Holly said, 18% of the population of Saskatchewan is Indigenous. And here in Nova Scotia, the Mi'kmaq are the first people. And the Mi'kmaq represent about 5.6% of the Nova Scotia population across 13 communities and in urban centers. So it is the fastest growing population. But our estimates, our best estimates of the number of Mi'kmaq nurses here in Nova Scotia is about 1.5%. So we're aiming, similar to Saskatchewan, of having at least 5.6% of the population of nurses be Mi'kmaq. So there are significant gaps in the data on the number of Mi'kmaq and Indigenous nurses in Nova Scotia. And we're really working on how we can improve ownership of that data by Mi'kmaq, but also respectful and authentic and accurate ways to collect that information. So we know there is evidence of inequitable and unsafe healthcare experiences. It's similar here in Nova Scotia as it is across the country. Through our work, we've learned that there is a preference for care first by Mi'kmaq and Indigenous nurses, and then by non-Mi'kmaq who are trauma-informed and can provide culturally safe care. So I'm going to pass it over to Dawn now to share what is known from the Indigenous faculty and student perspective.
Hi, everyone. My name is Dawn Gugu. I'm a Mi'kmaq nurse from Wagabaw First Nation, one of the Indigenous communities here in Nova Scotia. So I'm just going to talk more about the work we've been doing with the schools of nursing and Indigenous people in the school and recruitment. So, I'm going to need you to advance there when I need to, Lois. So what we do know from CASN, there was a report that was produced, and for the baccalaureate program, there's been 337 Indigenous people being admitted into programs across the country. There's 976 enrolled and graduate 218. So I'll get you to advance. So a part of the Trailblaze Oulu Nursing Initiative was something we were working on and creating, you know, and it started with some experiences that I've had and other nurses that I've been, other nurses that I know and work with within our communities. So I'm just going to get you to back up there, Lois. So similar to the CASN framework, we developed our own, which is has kind of two areas. It's pre-admission engagement and support, in which we engage the community and we help prepare for applications and different admission pathways. Many Indigenous communities lack the scientific courses they need to get into nursing. So chemistry and biology is the main ones. And so sometimes we need a different path where we need to get those courses somewhere else, or maybe there's some program in a university that can help guide that person into getting into nursing. So I'm going to use I have an example of a gentleman that wanted to become a nurse when he first came to see me. He had just done some courses in a university, and he thought he could transfer them over and was very excited to become a nurse. And when I looked at his information, there was nothing that would transfer over. So he started by doing a transition program in the university, which actually took me a while to get him in, because he already had university courses that had a barrier, because that program was only for people that had none, which really was a barrier, because, and it made no sense to me that he couldn't be accepted with nothing transferring over. So then he ended up going into college to get the chemistry and the biology. And now he's in nursing school and he just finished his first semester. So that process, you know, I met him in 2001 at the beginning of that year, and now he's finally in nursing school. So that's what I mean by pathways. Like everybody, I always ask, like, what do you need to get into nursing, or how can we get you there? And the other part is the admission and transition to practice. So the learning environments in the schools to ensure they're safe. The curriculum is trauma-informed and inclusive of Indigenous people, and that follows through into a practice, having relevant information to practice with Indigenous people. I'm going to just get you to land. There you go. Thank you. When I first started to work, I was kind of loosely just keeping a track of who was contacting me, what they were contacting me for. So with this information, I kind of analyzed what the students were needing. So a lot was it academic work that they needed, help with papers, test writing. Finances was very big. Scholarships and awards. So this was an area that doesn't, a lot of Indigenous folk are actually hesitant to fill in forms, and that actually relates to the past. And so they don't understand the forms, they don't know how to apply for these scholarships. So, you know, sitting somebody down and guiding through the application process, and there's always that section of community involvement, you know, where the application is looking for Girl Guides or any volunteer activity, where our Indigenous communities don't have these recognized organizations. But, you know, we've helped our grandmother every Sunday. We help with our solid days when somebody has passed away. We have community events, and those are the things that are that I helped guide in the scholarships, which usually aren't recognized, I guess, in other areas. Psychological, so there's a lot of mental health issues that come through with hearing things and learning things, you know, hearing what your peers are saying, and that really affects your learning. And cultural enrichment, there is no safe space or to be proud of who you are, because you do feel very alone in these programs when you're the only person in the program. And also the other one was accessing our safe space. So that was the space that was created in one university out of all the universities in Nova Scotia. And I'll get you to advance. So here's an environmental scan that was done in 2021 about schools of nursing that have addressed the TRC in some way. So of the 107 programs, less than one-fifth met culturally met cultural safe criteria. More than one half had cultural safe spaces. 20 satisfied the TRC calls to action number 4, which meant they had Indigenous relevant course, and 1/3 had Indigenous content in the curricula. So I'll get you to advance. Thank you. So some of the factors that were barriers with another study that was identified by Wilson in 2011 was that students they didn't have the ability to affirm their identity, which I just mentioned, the need for academic support. students don't feel safe asking for support or coming to seek support, access to Indigenous role models and mentors, relevant clinical placements, supportive teaching and learning environments, Indigenous content and curricula, family commitments and childcare, and accessing support. And so when we started looking at this and the work we were doing with the students, we started to think about some questions and some of our foundational questions that led us to have do some research and keep going with this work were, who are the Indigenous people applying into nursing school? Of those, who's applying and getting admitted? How are their Indigenous identity being captured? Is it authenticated? Does it benefit them in any way? What is their experience in the School of Nursing? Are they graduating? And how are the schools of nursing and health settings addressing the TRC calls to action in Nova Scotia? Are the schools of nursing places where Indigenous people can succeed and feel safe? So we developed a survey, which is now at the end stages of being approved for ethics. And in the development of the survey, we made up the questions and used the students that were there to help guide us to create the survey. So I don't want to talk too much about that. And then another area was the Olnu Data Project, which was done in August 2022. And this project was to find out some of those foundational questions that I had just mentioned. So, and these were our partners in that project. So all of us within the Indigenous Health Chair that working together, along with Dajigimic, which is the Mi'kmaq Health Authority. And then the Department of Labor and Advancement in Education, Department of Health and Wellness, and the Educational Institutes and the Schools of Nursing. So what we found from the data project, we had five educational institutes. So we have three universities, NSCC and four universities, seven organizations. And what we found was that there was a strong interest by the educational and organizational institutes to address the TRC. And most responders identified the need for more information on how to implement the TRC. And we also revealed that the data had a lot of inflation with the Indigenous student numbers due to the lack of process related to verification identity, and not clear how the data collected was consistently used to benefit Mi'kmaq or Indigenous nursing students. So with this, we proposed a plan on how we can help increase Indigenous recruitment and retention of nurses. So our plan was to create an office for provincial director of Mi'kmaq Indigenous nursing, a community-led pathway for verification of Indigenous students, a admission pathway to transitioning into practice that also has a database for OCAP principals, and a cultural safe trauma-informed schools of nursing, including the CASN framework. And one of the positions that we thought that would need to go with this proposed plan was the director and four Indigenous nurse education specialists, which would be designated for each school to help with that framework. And so with the Indigenous nurse education specialists, they would focus on the recruitment and retention. So that's like outreach, partnership with communities, expert academic advice, for potential students, student navigation into nursing programs, psychosocial funds, cultural support, and the decolonization and indigenization of curriculum, learning experiences, clinical placements in health system, and transition practice to partnerships with organizations, expertise to support success in the workplace. And Holly had mentioned earlier, you know, if you want to help with Indigenous people, you need Indigenous people involved. And one of the issues in Nova Scotia is that we have no Indigenous faculty. Oh, we have one, but she's not a nurse in all our schools of nursing. So trauma-informed schools, I'm going to switch it over to Margo so she can talk more about that. Thank you.
Thanks, Dawn. Incredible. And Dawn is our champion leading us forward. And so this is another aspect of the All New Nursing Initiative, but it will, I guess, support other initiatives with our in our school for underrepresented groups. So we're hoping to adopt a provincial trauma-informed approach to the schools of nursing. And currently the province has been working with us, the clinical lead for the province for trauma-informed care has been providing us with some support on how to adapt that process within our school of nursing. So we can look at our processes, our recruitment and retention policies, curriculum, learning environment, role descriptions, et cetera. So how can all of that be trauma-informed? So we're looking forward to working on that as part of this initiative. Next slide. So as you can see, we really believe the strengths of our work is that it is a provincial initiative. We're working on the mandate of the provincial government as well as the Mi'kmaq and Nation from this area. It's Mi'kmaq led, it's Mi'kmaq informed. We're working with the educational framework put out by CINA and CASN. It's capacity building in us as non-Indigenous people, but also within the system. It aligns with the education and health delivery outcomes and the trilateral memorandum of understanding between the nation and the province. And it's hopefully a template for other health profession schools addressing the TRC calls to action and the provincial action plan. So I guess what's left to do is to think about how we can all work together to implement this accreditation standard. Hopefully today has been an opportunity to think about really the complexity of that, that it isn't just a course, I guess, as we said at the beginning, but all of the key components and puzzle pieces that need to fit together and our responsibility as individuals, as faculty, as within our roles of how we can move forward in this work. So one of the final pieces we thought we might leave you with is the impact of some of this mentorship that we've shared with you through Dawn's work, through Holly's work, and the work that we've been doing through the chairs, and to bring the student perspective.
Hello, my name is Sharissa Hanke. I'm a white settler, a registered nurse, a nursing instructor, and an anti-racism educator. Dr. Holly Graham selected me for a Reconciliation Award in 2020, midway through my master's in education, where I organized and implemented anti-racism learning sessions and researched white nursing faculty's responses. I studied under anti-racism educator and expert Dr. Verna St. Denis because I believed that in order for nursing programs to implement TRC Call to Action number 24, it's imperative that we learn from professions like education, who have a robust and established body of rich anti-racism scholarship going back decades. If we are to educate new nurses to provide culturally safe anti-racist care, we need the skills of critical analysis that anti-racism provides, especially an analysis of whiteness and power. The transformative power of anti-racism education to disrupt the harmful status quo gives me hope that change is possible, and together we can dismantle systemic racism here in Canadian healthcare.
My name is Ariel. I'm a newly graduate Mi'kmaq nurse. Dawn and the work of the All New Nursing Initiative project came to me at a time in my degree that I was struggling and feeling completely isolated. Dawn provided me with studying tips, organizational advice, and ways to prioritize my busy schedule and to find time for myself and mental well-being. Most importantly, Dawn connected me to those I could learn more about my culture from, like Elder and Lavalawa. The Nursing Lounge has also provided me a safe space where I have met with many Indigenous nursing students. We have been able to help each other in our nursing degree and share our knowledge with one another.
My name is Dylan, Don.
My name is Ariel.
That's great. So this is really just a summary slide of some of the work that we've been doing to support Indigenous students in the school and our plan moving forward, how we want to engage more Indigenous people into the nursing program and support them while they're in nursing, and support faculty and staff to understand how to support them in nursing and transition to practice. So everyone working together to address the calls to action, just a reminder of that call, but really, I guess, just finishing on that call and really centering it in our work and all of the ways that we can work with our partners, build relationships, but also you can see how the specific strategies really create meaningful change for the Indigenous students and faculty and staff within our schools of nursing. So really a last mentee question, what do you need to continue your work in responding to the TRC calls to action? Has what we've shared with you today shared some of what you think you might need, or does it shape your thinking, or does it change your plan?
I just want to say your answers are really important as we plan and move forward to see what are the gaps, what other types of supports or information do nurses in our country need to move forward in a meaningful way to respond to TRC calls to action. So we would really appreciate if you could just be really straightforward with us, like what is it that you need, so that we can advocate for what it is that you say you need and find ways to provide what is necessary to advance the TRC calls to action in Canada. Well, someone said resources. So if you could elaborate as to what type of resources, that would be fantastic.
One thing I'll mention, Holly, is that I didn't mention that we did get funds for a provincial, for our proposal that we did put through in Nova Scotia. So we're getting ready to start that, to create an office of Oulu nursing that's going to support Indigenous students across Nova Scotia. So that's in the works.
That's wonderful. Because as we've mentioned, not only are these webinars at an end, this is the second set of the 5 workshops, but my chair ends this year, September 30th, 2024. So most of our chairs end. And so once our chairs end, the funding we have had been provided will no longer be available. So we've funded many of these initiatives. I know that I have in Saskatchewan, because it's very clear as one of, we need resources, there have not been resources dedicated. So I think when you're looking at your strat plans in your institution, not only putting in the strategy, but allocating money. And that is a very important conversation. Very important conversation. I'm just reading some of the comments here. I think part of the challenge for me has been, and as we look, collectively look at this work, is there really wasn't the infrastructure to actually, we didn't have the data, we weren't able to evaluate, metrics weren't in place. So I think with us going into our fifth year of chairs, I think we have provided collectively through the 6 chairs a foundation to start from and a place from which to begin. Have brought together a lot of the research and have identified the barriers and also ways to create partnerships and ways to even in your classroom, how to integrate calls to action by just even talking about the history. The history is something all Canadians need to know. And particularly when we're teaching, that's something that's common knowledge, should be common knowledge. And we weren't taught that in K-12, but that is something that we should all become comfortable with.
These are great. You can see the cyclical nature if we don't bring in or engage and support more Indigenous people in our nursing programs. We can't graduate them. We can't have nursing faculty who are Indigenous to help address and work with us to address the TRC calls to action. So it really is a cyclical challenge. So we really need to begin with the engagement and support within the system. And I saw one that says, we don't want to exhaust Indigenous people who are supporting us at this point. And that's a really key piece of the work that we're doing, because we really are eager to move this forward. But I know my colleagues are very respectful of that.
That was one thing we considered in our proposal as well, is that to have an office of Indigenous nurses as opposed to one person trying to do the work, so that they can actually support each other and support into those schools. Because doing this work, I've come across racism from the institutes and the faculty and students. So, you know, it's hard. It's hard dealing with those situations as you go, and you need that support of others to help guide you, and so you can continue to work.
That's a really key piece, is a critical mass of people who are working together on it. It's not just one person. It needs to be a group of people working who support each other, because as Dawn said, racism exists in our schools of nursing, in the health system, for the student Indigenous students who go into clinical placements. And it's very lonely. It's very difficult. And not knowing who to go to for support. So if it's a group of people who are working together, who understand the challenges, it makes for a more successful transition.
That is really important, because if you feel like you're doing it all alone, it's too onerous and it's mentally exhausting. And the six of us chairs worked together, and that was an incredible support system for all of us to support each other and then to support our graduate students. You can even just start a subcommittee within your faculty to address TRC calls to action or Indigenization or whatever you want to call it, and look at different places you would like to start. And you've had a lot of resources with the five workshops if you review them, and a lot of structure to work towards. So, but it's not easy picking a place to start. And I can appreciate that.
And there is a lack of Indigenous leaders, in the sense that when they went to their nursing school, they faced the racism and they went back to areas where they feel safe. And that school wasn't the one. So, you know, you see the graduate level of nursing, there really isn't too many. And we also need to work on that. So to start having Indigenous nurses in the school, they're not going to have those degrees of higher education, but we need to help them get there along the way.
So Go ahead, Holly. I can see you're about to speak.
I was just wondering about the provider alliance scale. You know, like people are wondering about what can they do about the relationship and whatnot. Perhaps we can send it out in the email. It's just not enough time to get into it.
So thank you today for your attention and engagement and all of your wonderful answers and thoughts. Looks like we have about 5 minutes left. If there are any outstanding or burning questions, I think we had asked that at the beginning. If there's anything you'd like to share or just a comment, you can have a look at the chat.
And this is the last session. There's one person who says that they don't have it as their last one. This is the last session. And we are going to leave a couple minutes for Judy to say a couple words. Mm-hmm.
Okay, and I'm driving right now. I'm going from one thing to another. But I was listening through the whole conversation and keeping it on my cell phone here and listening. And obviously lots and lots of hard work and hard conversations going out throughout Canada and through the nursing training and all the concerns about racism and implementing the TRC calls to action. And we have to keep the momentum going. We can't, and I know and see that we have good allies that are working with us to make these calls to action to implement them, and also that we continue to work together as we I'm just going to pause here for a second. Continue to work together as we continue our conversations. And also the bravery for all of you to be with us and continue to work with the Indigenous people. And our elders always say nothing about us without us. And so thank you very much for having me. And I'm really honored to be a part of this. And sometimes I get called to emergency meetings like with FSIN and Missing and Murdered Indigenous. It wasn't on my calendar, but I don't like to say no when that happens. But I also, I was able to stay on here. It was finally over. And so I've been on the conversations, but just leaving from one device to another was all I missed. So thank you so very much and keep up the good work. And I shall keep you in my prayers as I go about my days, and that we keep doing the hard work, the having those hard conversations, and very proud of the Indigenous chairs of nursing that are doing such a tremendous job for us. And again, thank you so much. And we'll see you when next time or when we see one another. Jimmy, thank you.
And if you've missed the opportunity in terms of what type of educational series that you need to do this work, please put it in the chat box or send an email so that we can continue to advocate and plan ways to bridge those gaps.
Thank you so much to our presenters and to knowledge holder Judy Pelly for your words today. I know it was really impactful. We're always getting messages that people love these workshops and they apply what they've learned back to their students and their institutions. So as we're wrapping up this series, thank you for the time that you take and the knowledge that you share. We really appreciate it. Thank you.
And thank you to you, Lois, and Christine and James, and the team at CASN for supporting our work and helping us share the message and the support for this series.
Yes, thank you very much. It was a wonderful opportunity for us and to connect with our colleagues across Canada. So thank you.
And Darcy as well for the translations.
Yes, thank you, Darcy, for the translation.
Have a great evening, everyone.